Can my LLC name be different from my business name? In this video, we're going to talk about the pros and cons, and I'm going to give you some golden tips. I call an LLC or an entity an airplane. At the end of the video, I'm going to tell you why you never land a plane. And if you want legacy work and you don't want all these extra costs, stay to the end. You better get a pen and paper. I'll give you details on what I do when I set up an entity. So three things I'm going to talk about, and I'll just give you the answer right now. Absolutely, yes, the entity LLC name or the company name can be different than the actual operating business name. I'll call it URL. Absolutely. Number two, I'm going to talk about DBAs, right? Doing business as, and how do you do that? And what are the legal requirements to do that? Why a bank's going to need it? And then the last is, how do you use a variety of different entities? What do you use for brands? What do you do with the database? What do you do with intellectual property? How do you do all this stuff? So here's what I think about entities. I think when someone's 18 years old and you're a legal adult, we have this amazing thing in the United States called the tax code. Over 81,000 pages, not items, pages. And in all of that is 260 something resolutions. So you take all this code and you take all these resolutions and you maximize your life. You live what we call corporate life. See, I don't really have a program I teach people. I have a lifestyle that we teach people. And it starts when you are an adult at 18 years old, you give your kids an LLC for their birthday. That's how serious I am about getting an entity. Now, given that you're gonna get one really young, and I had entities really young. I had my first C Corp at 21 years old. So what do you do with them? Do you have to have the right name? Absolutely not. There's this thing called the DBA. What I would tell people, and especially you women who want to have some fancy LLC name, I would never use your name. Why have your name out into what's called the SOS, the Secretary of State? So why would you advertise Loral Langemeier owns this multi-million dollar company and her, you know, son Logan is right behind and then, you know, whoever else's ownership. Why would you like just lay out front, you know, who owns it? I like really unique names, right? So all sorts of whatever, ABC, XYZ, 123, acronyms for funny things. I have somebody who has the CCLLC, and I said, what's that stands for? And they said, cash flow chaos. All right, doesn't have to mean anything. You could have, you know, five S's. You could say like the 5S Corporation or 5S Ventures and have five kids with S names, Sally, Sam, Steve, whatever you want to do. My advice to you is when you're naming your LLC, keep it generic because what you want is the history of an entity. So I'm going to give you a little moment of a story of why I'm not a fan of sole proprietors. Well, first of all, just inheriting a sole proprietor means you're solo, which means you're going to do all the work. And inside of a company, there's marketing, there's sales, there's accounting, there's operations, there's fulfillment, there's technology, customer service. You got all these things to do. There's no way one person as a solopreneur can do anything. You put everything you have at risk, meaning like if you get sued, especially if you're in like the finance space, you want to protect everything you're saying because somebody, believe me, I've been there, says, well, I read your book and I'm going to sue you because I did what you said in your book or you told me what to do something. Worse in the finance space is the health space. And so many of you, chiropractors, even in direct sales companies, you're selling supplements. And people are going to say, well, but you know, you gave me advice. You said I should take the supplement and I had this reaction to it. Now I'm going to sue you. So what an entity does is it protects you as an individual against other people. And those of you that are listening in America, it's not just America anymore. We're in a pretty litigious world right now. So everything you own should be wrapped up in a corporation, according to the rules of living corporate life. Plus, just think about your taxes. You can either make money, use 81,000 pages of deduction and pay tax on what's left, which means you're going to live corporate life thoroughly. That includes employing your children, having Roth IRAs, having qualified plans, or you can make money, be taxed to pieces, and live what's on left. So you choose your tax code, by the way, as you make these decisions. Back to the name. Does the name matter? No. I want that name of the entity to live not only in your generation, but I want you to then pass it through with a trust and have it go to the next generation. I plan on many of the corporations and LLCs and entities I've set up to last for generations and generations after me. I always expect that my great-great-great-grandkids are someday gonna have the entities that I started as an adult. And some of you say, well, this is serious stuff. This is legacy work. That's why I'm doing it though. You don't have to do it for legacy work. You could do it just as a simple partnership. But even in a partnership, let's just say I go do a business with somebody. right? And there's just two of us, and we will go 50-50 and do an LLC. At the end of that business, and say we sell the assets and whatever's inside of it, I always keep those entities. I close the bank accounts, I clean them up, I make sure they're pristine, and I put them on the shelf for about a year. So, and then I take them off the shelf if I have a new partnership. And you say, well, why do you keep them? See, that's the biggest mistake people make. They start them, they default, or they close them. They start them, they close them. When you start an entity, it gives you the legal right to do the most amazing tax deductions, asset protection, liability protection. The thing that no one talks about is corporate credit. So you, as an individual, have your Social Security number. Well, you have a tax ID and employee ID number as a company. So let's just say there's you and you have two companies. Now you have three sources of credit. You have yours, you have your own credit score, and each company can have corporate credit. So the more you have, the more access to funding you have, the more access to capital that you have, the more viable you look as a business owner. So it isn't about the name, is the point of the video. It's not about the name at all. It's about the duration and the use and the financial appropriate use and documentation of this company being a company. Now you say, well, what if I've changed? Well, I did. I'll give you my exact story. I have had a company, well, I'll just say it's a long time, but when I met Robert Kiyosaki and Sharon Lecter and became the cash flow distributor, that company had a name and it sold cash flow products, right? It sold the rich dad, poor dad stuff. People would go to that website. They'd order cash flow 202. They'd order all the products. And then I thought, well, if I can do one brand, why don't I do other brands? So all of a sudden I took this one brand and I added more and more and more to it. When I was done between 1996 and 2000, I represented 18 different success, wealth building, tax strategy brands. Yes, I sold Michael Gerber stuff. I sold Brian Tracy stuff, Zig Ziglar stuff, Keith Cunningham stuff, Blair Singer stuff. I sold a lot of people's stuff because I had a database of people that were buying and buying and buying. And where did I find them all? Plain cash flow. My point is I didn't name that entity cash flow distribution. I didn't name it anything. It was just a generic name that had a lot about your financial choice. And then subsequently, when I stopped selling all them, I always say I eBayed it out of my plane, right? I got rid of all the inventory and I kept it as an open company. About a year later, I kept it open. Now I got all this history of all this money, hundreds of thousands of dollars running through that company. Gave it a DBA, a doing business as, a new name, and it started again with a whole different brand and a whole different sequence. So keeping your entity open allows you access to get funding and finance and credit, and no one talks about that. No one talks about that part. And what drives me probably the most crazy are those accountants out there who make forming an entity have everything to do with how much money you make. It has nothing to do with how much money you make. It has to do with the intention of the life you want. Do you want to live corporate life? As an 18-year-old, guess what? Your company, no one knows this resolution. We use it heavily. As an 18-year-old, say you want to go to college. Say your company owns real estate. Well, your company that owns real estate can send you to college and you can have a resolution for 100% college reimbursement for every expense that you're not scholarshiped or your parents or somebody won't pay for. So you're going to walk your way through college on a corporate resolution that is going to pay for everything. Guess what? You can go to a training. You can do all sorts of things inside corporate structure you cannot do as an individual. So I want you to own nothing. I want you to control everything. The name of your entity, make them fun. All right, make them fun. Make up some acronyms of some fun things you have. Somebody already took this because they like listened to my videos, but MSU, right? Make stuff up, right? It's been a saying of mine forever. Do you know how many MSU LLCs are across the United States in different states? Because they took them in the state that they were in. They have MSU LLC. They can do what anything they want with it. They can sell real estate with that. They could sell supplements with that. They could have a chiropractic business with it. It doesn't matter. You're going to DBA it. Now let's talk about that for a moment. Before I go into the DBA, I'm going to do a quick request. If you're enjoying this content and you want more, and you know there's way more content up here, I need you to do two things. Hit a subscribe button, click the notification button so you get this every day, 5 days a week, and share it, share it, share it, share it, especially in these conversations, because these entities, if you are in a significant relationship, family, or partnership, they're all gonna have to agree to this. So you need to get them in the same philosophy. So share my videos and like them, get everybody listening to them. Now, here's how you use a DBA. And it's a legal document. You actually go down to your courthouse, you go to the county clerk, you fill out what's called the fictitious name agreement. And it's a DBA. And why it's critical is if you go out with XYZ company, but all of a sudden you have ABC supplements and you're not DBA ABC supplements and somebody writes you a check or wires you money and it doesn't match ABC supplements, they're going to send the money back. So it's a banking issue more than it's anything. Your DBAs have to do with the banking, the money side of the house, because the DBA, your fictitious name agreement, is the document. It's one page, super simple. You can fill it out right there where you're standing at the county clerk. You're going to hand it in. It might cost $20 or something. You have to do that. Then you take a copy of it stamped by the county clerk down to the bank. Now the bank will receive wires or Venmos or Cash App money based on the DBA name. So you can have XYZ LLC your whole life and it can have DBA. Guess what? 3 years later, you have a different company and it's L3 Enterprises. Well, then you're gonna go back down. You're gonna change the fictitious name agreement. You can either close it or just add it on. And so over time, you can have three or four different DBAs on the same LLC because money's gonna be coming in differently. And I tell you, you're gonna run right into having money sent back if you don't have that DBA on file at the bank. So hopefully this is great information. Hopefully you get it. Keep these planes in the air. That is my $1 trillion tip. The longer you can keep an entity alive, the longer you have corporate history, you have financial history, you want credit cards in the company name, you want to jam. Like, there is so much money to be available if you live corporate life. So let me help. Here's how we're going to start. You're going to go to a financial personality quiz. Yes, I'm going to ask you to do this over and over and over. I want you, for those of you who've been listening, those of you just meeting me, take the quiz. It takes about 30 seconds. I'm going to send you back who you are as a financial personality. It'll be followed up with a video of what to do. And then I'm going to send you an application that takes about another minute maybe to fill out. And that application is to talk to somebody one-on-one privately about your situation, what you've done to yourself. And we'll go from there. But you need to live corporate life. If you're 18 or older listening to this, your life should be inside of a corporate structure. So let's begin today. And we'll talk again tomorrow.